Harper Audio presents Attack of the 50-Foot Women, How Gender Equality Can Save the World, by Catherine Mayer, read by Tanya Moodie. If we were socially ambisexual, if men and women were completely and genuinely equal in their social roles, equal legally and economically, equal in freedom, in responsibility, and in self-esteem, then society would be a very different thing. What our problems might be, God knows. I only know we would have them. But it seems likely that our central problem would not be the one it is now, the problem of exploitation. Exploitation of the woman, of the weak, of the earth. Ursula Le Guin, Is Gender Necessary? The Language of the Night, Essays on Fantasy and Science Fiction, 1976. Introduction: The Shoulders of Giants. A colossal zombie Scarlett Johansson commandeered London's red buses a few years ago. She sprawled across the upper deck of a fleet of vehicles, face slack with simulated desire, mouth gaping wide enough to swallow a small terrier, breasts threatening to smother passengers seated in the lower tier. Dolce & Gabbana's advertising campaign intended to evoke Marilyn Monroe's heyday, and it succeeded. The apparition recalled Nancy, the title character of a 1958 film, Attack of the 50-Foot Woman. Nancy's encounter with a space alien transforms her into a giant. Incredibly huge, with incredible desires for love and vengeance. The patriarchal authorities, doctors, police, spouse, chain her. But she breaks free and, naked but for an arrangement of bedsheets, embarks on a murderous rampage. Behold the dreadful power of woman unleashed, the most grotesque monstrosity of all. Zombie Johansson captured the inadvertent humour of the B-movie. But she was properly scary, too. In her human incarnation, she's the only woman to break through Hollywood's diamond ceiling to claim a place among the 10 top-grossing actors of all time. She chooses intelligent roles and has more than once pushed back against the chauvinism of Hollywood and its media ecosystems. Her dead-eyed alter ego belonged to the monstrous regiment of billboard women in perpetual march across the world. Nancy gained agency as she grew. Today's 50-footers, hypersexualized and supine, promote a retrograde ideology alongside brands and products. We're so marinated in this imagery that we seldom stand back to parse its meaning and impact. It is all pervasive. Not just on hoardings and print and broadcast, but metastasized into myriad digital forms. The underlying messaging is little different to the drumbeat that helped return women to the pliant domesticity after World War II. From earliest childhood, girls are taught to value themselves for their abilities. Desirability, marriageability, tractability. There are, of course, other role models. Women of stature and astonishing achievement, but still they break through against the odds. Globally, women own less and earn less than men, often in the worst and worst regulated jobs, undertake the lioness's share of caregiving and unpaid domestic labour, and are subject to discrimination, harassment, and sexual violence. Every woman navigates a world fashioned by and for men. Female drivers are more vulnerable to serious injury from accidents in many models of car, because until recently, crash test dummies were built only to male dimensions. Some pharmaceuticals fail us because they are tested on male animals to avoid having to account for hormonal cycles. We shiver at our workplaces because thermostats are set to temperatures that suit male metabolisms. We're left in the cold in other ways too. The Organization for European Economic Cooperation, OEEC, logs the gap between women's earnings and men's at 17.48% in the UK, 17.91% in the US, and 18% in Australia. Women have long been blamed for this gap. We don't ask for raises often enough, or we don't ask right. Studies identify the real culprits: job segregation and discrimination. Jobs traditionally performed by men attract higher wages than those held by women. Female employees of Birmingham City Council, working as care home attendants, cooks, and cleaners, discovered they were paid less than the mostly male refuse collectors and street cleaners on the council payroll. Although women are the main breadwinners in many households, and dual earner households are also common, the paradigm of the husband as the head of the household and chief provider remains firmly lodged in the public imagination. One reason some employers pay men better may be that they think the men have greater need of the money. In the US, men in nursing are vastly outnumbered by their female colleagues, by 9-1, yet earn $5,100 more on average per year than female nurses. These disparities are echoed across the world. Every woman lives with a constant tinnitus hum of low-level sexism. Most of us have been leered at or lecherd over and told we should be flattered by the attention. For 1 in 5 women in Europe, that flattering attention takes the form of sexual assault. Almost a fifth of US women will be raped in their lifetimes, with close to half reporting other forms of sexual violence. 1 in 3 women worldwide will be subjected to violent sexual attack. The response to this epidemic is muted and muddled. In the US, prosecutors ask a judge to send a college athlete to prison for 6 years for sexually assaulting an unconscious woman. The judge decides in 6 months, concerned a longer period of incarceration will have a severe impact on the perpetrator. He is freed halfway through his sentence. In India, a woman is gang raped to death. One of her rapists says, "A decent girl won't roam around at 9 o'clock at night. A girl is far more responsible for rape than a boy." In Pakistan, 14 men rape a woman on the orders of their village council as punishment for her brother's supposed liaison with a local woman. The majority of the 276 schoolgirls kidnapped by terrorists in northern Nigeria are still missing. Those who escape, bearing tales of mass rape and slavery, find themselves social outcasts. Egyptian lawmakers finally approve a draft bill that would dole out 5 to 7 year jail terms for people carrying out female genital mutilation, FGM, an operation to remove part or all of the clitoris. The procedure, often called circumcision by those trying to minimize its brutality, has been inflicted on more than 90% of the country's women and girls. We are a population whose men suffer from sexual weakness, which is evident because Egypt is among the biggest consumers of sexual stimulants, an MP protests. If we stop circumcising, we will need strong men, and we don't have those. Up to 1,000 women are sexually assaulted on the streets of the German cathedral city of Cologne on New Year's Eve, 2015. The attacks trigger condemnation not of women's oppression, but of migration, reinforcing the false narrative that sexual violence is imported, rather than native to white European society. In South Africa, a Paralympian shoots his girlfriend, a would-be lawyer and successful model. Newspapers across the world use an image from a bikini photo shoot to illustrate coverage, which focuses on his achievements and barely mentions her. A court in China finds Zhang Yazhu guilty of strangling 24-year-old Li Hongjia, whom he had abused for years, but gives Zhang a lesser sentence than is standard for murder cases because Li was his wife. And on the 8th of November 2016, US voters choose their president. The front runners are a female candidate and a man who has been recorded boasting of assaulting women. "You know, I'm automatically attracted to beautiful. I just start kissing them. It's like a magnet. Just kiss. I don't even wait. And when you're a star, they let you do it. You can do anything. Grab them by the pussy. You can do anything," he says. After the recording emerges, 10 women come forward to accuse him of assault. He insists that they are lying. After all, 2 of them were too ugly to grope. Many other aspects of his candidacy should also repel any voter who values equality. The candidate appears to believe only in himself, that panders to Christian social conservatives by promising to roll back women's reproductive rights. He lets it be known that he will back a law to permit discrimination against gays and lesbians by anyone who claims religious grounds for their stance. He stirs up racism and gains the support of the Ku Klux Klan by pledging to ban Muslims from the country and force Mexico to build a wall to keep its own citizens from crossing the border into the US. He refuses to condemn his supporters for racist violence. He is the worst would-be president many of us have seen in our lifetimes or read about in history books. Dangerous, incoherent, and vain. He cozies up to Russian autocrat Vladimir Putin, publicly invites the Russian Secret Service to hack US government emails to damage his opponent, and announces he will unpick years of international negotiations to limit climate change, which he calls a hoax. He wins the election. A majority of men votes for him, by 53% to 41%. A majority of white people votes for him, by 58% to 37%. 81% of white evangelicals and born-again Christians vote for him. Women vote against him, by 54% to 42%. Yet, a majority of white women supports him, 53%. A dual US and UK national, I cast a ballot in my home state of Wisconsin. I am not one of the white women who helped Donald Trump into the White House. But like all white American women, I am implicated. Through researching this book, I also understand the mechanisms that encourage turkeys to vote for Christmas. This book aims to set out those insights and to make something else abundantly clear. The skewed status quo serves almost nobody, certainly not most men. The world is full of decent men who strive to be allies to women. It's a safe bet that most men who are engaged enough in these issues to read these pages fall into this category, though you may not always be sure how best to support us. Many of you want change, for women and girls, and for yourselves, but you don't always understand that women's issues are your issues. You observe your own sex suffering within patriarchal cultures and structures, but don't always join the dots. Because of these structures, boys struggle at school. Suicide rates are highest among young males, who are also more likely to murder and more likely to be murdered. And men drink more heavily and more frequently end up in prison. Fathers yearn to be with their children, but the enduring pay gap means they cannot afford to stay home, while social norms sometimes deter them from pushing for change. Businesses, institutions, and economies underperform. The 21st century wasn't supposed to be like this. Late boomers like me grew up believing history was going our way. We assumed progress to be linear, counting ourselves lucky to be born to an era that had all but vanquished the great scourges of humanity. Racism and homophobia proved susceptible to education, and so would wither. Wars were still prosecuted, but at a distance. Hunger, too, seemed confined to faraway lands, and technology must surely deliver fixes, just as it would soon banish cancer, aging, death, and clothes moths. As for women's rights, the heavy lifting had been done by the women and their male allies who came before us. A liberal consensus held sway, and growing up in comfort, largely surrounded by the white middle classes, I had no idea of the limits or vulnerabilities of our progress. After a peripatetic early childhood, I attended a girls' school in Northern England that proudly counted among its alumni all three daughters of the magnificent, if flawed, Emmeline Pankhurst. We learned that the suffragettes' achievements marked the beginning of the end of the gender wars. In 1918, as Europe made its fragile peace, the Representation of the People Act granted some British women the right to vote. A decade later, that right was extended to all adult females. New Zealand had led the way in 1893. The US followed suit in 1920. When I was seven and still living in the US, The doughty women of Ford Dagenham fought and won the battle for equal pay. Women's libbers and the pill were finishing the job. As teenagers, my contemporaries and I saw shimmering on the near horizon a fully gender-equal society in which every inhabitant could stand as tall as the next person. I named this place Equalia. And like a querulous child on a family outing, I spent much of my life asking, when will we get there? There's always someone prepared to claim we've already arrived. Such people rarely describe themselves as feminists, because they misunderstand the term as a doctrine of suppression. There is a mistaken conception that feminism is somehow dour, says Sandy Toksvig, broadcaster, writer, comedian, and, in the pungent prose of a Daily Mail columnist, a vertically challenged and openly lesbian mother. In a 2016 interview, Sandy said, "Aren't you all about burning your bras?" one man asked me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.